So the world changed for us at the beginning of 2020 with the emergence of COVID-19. And although we didn't know it at the time, Christmas 2019 would be the last normal holiday period that we'd have for some time. And many of us are still not really sure, certainly those of us living in Western Australia, don't really know when we might be able to travel freely again, to be able to visit friends and family and people we love across the country and internationally, and to visit places that we'd like to experience, as we did before. So the world is transitioning to the post-pandemic era. But we'll need to learn how to live with this new virus that's moved from animals into humans. And I propose to you that vaccination and personal responsibility are our tickets to post-pandemic life. So what are these coronaviruses that we keep hearing about? There are hundreds of coronaviruses, and they're all viruses of animals. They infect camels and dogs and cats, large cats and small cats, and bats, pangolins, and many, many other species. They've existed for thousands of years, and some of them have moved into humans before. You may know of severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus, or SARS, that emerged in 2003, and Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome, coronavirus, or MERS, that emerged in 2012. Both these viruses had very high fatality rates. But fortunately for us, SARS disappeared after about a year, and MERS doesn't move very easily between people. But as we've seen, SARS coronavirus 2, the most recent emergent virus that causes the disease COVID-19, moves very easily between people and across countries, and has killed a very large number of people so far, and it looks like this virus is here to stay. So our return to a life resembling the life we lived previously, prior to the emergence of COVID, is made possible by our immune systems and by vaccination. So SARS-CoV-2 enters your body when you breathe in virus particles that are suspended in the air around you and that have been expelled by infected people. They move into your lungs and infect your lung cells, damaging them in the process, and then move through your blood to infect your other organs, your heart, your kidneys, your bowel, your gut, and the linings of your blood vessels, damaging your body in the process. So your immune response is activated and stops virus replication. But for reasons we don't fully understand yet, some people are not able to mount such protective responses, and they're at great risk of developing severe disease and of dying. So we know that most people who are infected with this virus don't become sick or very sick. But here's the problem. You cannot be certain that you will not become very sick. So you can choose to protect yourself and be vaccinated, and protect yourself and people around you in the community. And at this point in the pandemic, we know very clearly that vaccination is protective. And we also know that natural infection can damage your body, your cells, your organs, in ways that can last, can have long-term consequences, right? And we also know that the infection can cause your immune system to switch and start acting on your own tissues. And the autoimmune diseases and other complications that result from this can be long-term. So how does vaccination protect you? So the COVID-19 vaccine trains your immune system by showing your immune cells a piece of the virus. Your trained immune cells then become memory cells that can stay in your blood for months or perhaps years, we don't really know yet, and will protect you, will fight the infection when you're exposed to the real infectious virus. When this happens, as it will for all of us, your trained memory cells will very quickly respond and fight the infection and protect you. So why are we concerned about these coronaviruses? What's so bad about them? So A virus is essentially a piece of genetic material, a viral genome, that's either DNA or RNA. And it's surrounded by a protective viral protein coat. SARS-CoV-2 is an RNA virus. So the viral genome, the RNA, instructs the cell that's been infected by the virus to switch, to start making viral proteins instead of the normal cellular proteins. And this is part of the damage that can be caused by this infection. The cell is also instructed to make millions of copies of the RNA genome, the next set of instructions. Someone who's infected, an infected person, can make up to 100 billion new viruses at the peak of their infection. And we know that many of these viruses have mistakes in the copied RNA. These mistakes are otherwise known as mutations. Some mutations don't make any difference to the virus. They're harmless to the virus. The virus continues to replicate and functions as normal. Many mutations have no effect at all. And some mutations will result in a virus that is much more transmissible, much more virulent. It's affected the way the virus replicates, and these viruses can be the ones that become variants of concern, right? So we've seen emergence of these variants since the beginning of the pandemic. The first one that we really recognize is the one we now call Alpha. And of course, we're now living in the time of Delta and possibly Omicron, but we'll see about that. So the vaccines that we receive now are all based on instructions by the original virus that emerged in late 2019, early 2020. So do these vaccines protect us against infection with these variants that have emerged since the beginning of the pandemic? So we know that people who've been vaccinated can be infected with Delta and other variants of concern, but we see very clearly that they are much better protected than people who are not vaccinated. They have very low viral loads compared to those people, and they are less likely to be hospitalized and to become very sick and be hospitalized, certainly compared to people who are not vaccinated. And there's one thing we can be sure of, is that new variants and mutants will continue to emerge and evolve as long as this virus is circulating. So it's our level of immunity that keeps virus from spreading, stops transmission, or at least slows it down, and also limits the opportunities for the viruses to evolve, to become more virulent. And this is what we aim to do. So it's our responsibility to be vaccinated and to limit transmission. And we know that vaccination is the very best way to do this. We also need to be aware that many people don't have good immune systems that work as they might. So they were born that way, or they acquired an infection that damaged, destroyed their immunity, or they're taking immunosuppressive medicines, as many people do, for all kinds of conditions, rheumatoid arthritis, for transplant, certainly, right? So those people are much more vulnerable to infection. And again, it's our responsibility as individuals and as communities to increase the level of immunity by vaccination, and so to protect these vulnerable people in our communities. This is what we call herd immunity, and it's always the aim. So we need to also be thinking about people who live in under-resourced countries, who still are vulnerable to this pandemic, to COVID-19, even this far into the pandemic. So I've worked with the World Health Organization and with Australia's Centre for Health Security in the Indo-Pacific region to assess laboratory capacity and public health infrastructure as part of the larger program to strengthen pandemic and epidemic preparedness. Right? And I can tell you that the people in these countries are the same as you. They want to live a normal life and to protect the people that they love. And again, it's our responsibility to limit the amount of virus that's available and to stop evolution, or prevent, slow down, evolution of new variants of concern that will threaten these vulnerable countries. I was born in the Pacific, in Tonga, and I'm very aware of how vulnerable these small island nations are to emerging viral diseases. So it's been a very difficult 2 years. In my chats with my friends and colleagues about emerging infectious diseases, we agree that this pandemic has been the training run for the virulent virus that's yet to emerge that will be highly transmissible and that will kill a lot of people. This virus X will be the virus that we really have been anticipating for a long time now. So how do we prevent this scenario from being worse than what we're experiencing now? We need to learn from what we're doing now and apply this to future pandemics. We've actually learned a tremendous amount scientifically and medically and socially in the past 2 years. And I'm confident that we'll be able to respond better next time. So we've reached a point in this pandemic where we can look forward and see a post-pandemic life. We'll be able to travel again and see people that we love and enjoy life more than we do now. When the borders come down, as they will, I'm sure, soon, we'll be able to do this, but we'll also be susceptible to the virus that will be transmitting, will be circulating around us. So again, we need to protect ourselves by vaccination, protect ourselves and people around us and our communities. We need to try to achieve this herd immunity. So no one is safe until everyone is safe. So thank you for listening, and I'll leave you with this final message. Increase your immunity and we'll control this virus.